What's up, everybody? Travag here, and today we're going to be doing an analysis of the Bow of Faerdhinen. We're going to be looking into how it stacks up against the T-Bow and the Blowpipe. We're also going to be looking at the cost, some quality of life, and some additional information. We're not going to be analyzing other ranged weapons. We're only going to be looking at these three as they cover most of the meta. Assume that other range items will have their niches, like Dragon Hunter Crossbow is probably going to be best in slot against certain dragons. First up, we're going to start with Chambers of Zarek. This is going to assume 99 range and rigor. If you're missing something like that, most of these calculations should still add up similarly. One thing to note with Chambers of Zarek is the Crystal Helm slot probably is not going to be used most of the time. People will opt to bring a Nader's Knot face guard or a Helm of Nader's Knot or even a Serp Helm. So these calculations will not include that. That being said, the Crystal Helm only provides a 5% accuracy increase and a 2.5% damage increase. If you do bring the helmet, you can bump these numbers up just a little bit. Secondly, the blowpipe will be using amethyst darts, since those are going to be the most readily available and probably the most abundant. If you're using rune darts, you can bump these numbers down a little bit. If you're using dragon darts, you can obviously bump them up. First up, let's take a look at Ohm Well Overloaded. T-Bow is the best in slot here. No surprises, really. It's roughly 30% better than the Bow of Faerdhinen. But if we take a look at the blowpipe versus the bow, they're pretty much equal. The difference is 0.31%. So really, it comes down to preference and the types of darts that you're going to be using. Next up, Skeletal Mystics. The best in slot here is actually the Bow of Faerdhinen. This is going to be roughly 25% stronger than the T-Bow and 32% stronger than the Blowpipe. Wow. Next up, we have Vasa. At Vasa, T-Bow is the best in slot by roughly 19% over the Bow of Faerdhinen, but the Bow and Faerdhinen does have 15% more DPS than the Blowpipe. At Vanguards, the only spot you'll be using range is going to be the Magic Vanguard, and the Bow of Faerdhinen is the best in slot here. Next up is the Blowpipe, which is only about 4% weaker than the F-Bow, and then trailing that, we have the T-Bow, which is about 10% weaker than the F-Bow. Shamans. As shamans, no surprises here. The blowpipe is going to be the best in slot. It is roughly 10% stronger than using the Bow of Faerdhinen. Now, if you're safe spotting or you enjoy staying far away from shamans, the Bow of Faerdhinen might be worth the 10% drop here because you'll be able to dodge a lot more easily. At the Deathly Rangers, the blowpipe is also going to be the best in slot here by roughly 8% over the Bow and Faerdhinen, while the T-Bow is going to be lower than that, not really going to be used against the Rangers. However, against the Majors, the T-Bow is the best in slot, roughly 6% stronger than a Blowpipe. When we're comparing the Blowpipe versus the F-Bow, the Blowpipe is roughly 15% stronger against the Deathly Majors at Tightrope. At Ice Demon, T-Bow is the best in slot, and it's roughly 50% stronger than the Bow of Faerdhinen, and the Bow of Faerdhinen is roughly 38% stronger than the Blowpipe. In the case where you don't own a T-Bow against the Ice Demon, the Bow of Faerdhinen is a sizable increase over the Blowpipe, similar to Skeletal Mystics. At Mutadiles, the small Mutadile, obviously we're not going to use the T-Bow there at all, but the Blowpipe is going to be better than the Bow of Faerdhinen by roughly 10%. For Mamadile, the T-Bow is sizably better than the Blowpipe by roughly 25%. But the Blowpipe is the second best weapon to use here. The Bow of Faerdhinen trailing only roughly 3% behind. Against the Abyssal Portal in the Vespula Room, you won't be using the Blowpipe at all here. But the Bow of Faerdhinen actually out-DPSs the T-Bow by roughly 10%. And that's it for the Chambers of Zarek. Overall, you can see that they're all fairly balanced in terms of where they can be used and where they excel best. In the situation where you don't own the T-Bow and you're bringing in the bow versus the blowpipe, depending on your setup, you might only bring one or the other. However, there are definitely going to be raids where you want to bring both, even if it means just using the blowpipe in one room or using the blowpipe for a spec. Remember that the blowpipe spec is very accurate and does boosted damage, so it can provide some extra DPS and extra healing. Next, we're going to be looking at God Wars Dungeon. Here, we're going to be using the full set of Crystal Armor, and in some cases, we're going to look at the calculations for Slayer Helm as well. Now, keep in mind, for some of these bosses, you definitely maybe would use melee or you'd use Chins at Armor. We're not going to factor those items in at all, since this video is focused on these three choices. First up, let's look at Krill. The best in slot here is actually the Bow of Faerdhinen. It's going to be out DPSing the T-Bow by roughly 3.5%. Obviously, the meta in terms of being able to shoot Krill without getting hit still needs to be developed. The Blowpipe is much weaker here, 50% weaker than the F-Bow. But of course, a lot of people will be using melee here, so let's keep that in mind. At Bandos, this is one of the areas where the bow really sets itself apart. The bow is going to be your best in slot here, and it's going to be 50% stronger than using the Blowpipe. The T-Bow cannot be used at Bandos due to its low magic level. At Ceridoman, we're not going to be using the Blowpipe at all, so we're comparing the T-Bow versus the F-Bow. The T-Bow is better, but it's only roughly around 13% better. So if you don't own a T-Bow, the F-Bow is a great choice, but of course it's going to have a higher upkeep cost than the T-Bow, but we'll get into that a little bit later. At Kriara, you'll probably be using Chins, but in the case where for whatever reason you're bringing one of these weapons, the Bow of Faerdhinen is actually the best in slot, better than the T-Bow by about 10%. The Blowpipe you're not going to be really using outside of the minions, of course. If using a Slayer Helm at these bosses, the cost of using the Crystal Armor will be reduced by 33% because you won't have the helmet. Other than that, most of the DPS calculations are the same. However, at Krill, using a Slayer Helm, the T-Bow does take over on DPS, but only marginally by about 5%. For this chapter, we're going to be taking a look at various bosses around Gilanor that haven't been covered so far. First up, the Giant Mole. We're not going to be using the Blowpipe at the Giant Mole, but comparing the T-Bow to the Bow of Faerdhinen, the T-Bow is better, but only by about 3 or 4%. So the F-Bow is actually a really, really good option here, and the upkeep cost is going to be pretty much nothing since the Mole's not going to hit you. Alright, at Zalra, we need to break this down into different phases. So first up, the green phase, the phase that's weak to mage. This is where you'd probably wouldn't use the Blowpipe ball. If you are bringing the Blowpipe, you would do a mage switch. But if we're looking at the T-Bow versus the F-Bow, the T-Bow is better. It's only better by about 4% here, assuming you're using full crystal. For the blue phase, the range phase, this is the phase where you will be using the Blowpipe. The T-Bow is still going to be the strongest weapon here, but when comparing the Bow of Faerdhinen to the Blowpipe, the bow is actually stronger here by about 6%. This was a bit of a surprise. I thought maybe the Blowpipe would still be better here, but according to these calculations, that's not going to be the case. This means that if you are bringing a mage switch, your range switch still might end up being the Bow of Faerdhinen over the Blowpipe. On the red phase of Zalra, this is more applicable if you're doing range only. The Bow of Faerdhinen actually out DPSs the T-Bow here by about 2%, assuming you're wearing full crystal armor. Now, after testing Zalra a bunch with this set, I came to the conclusion that I actually prefer to wear Serp Helm instead of the Crystal Helm. Since I was doing range only with the bow, it was much more comfortable to actually sacrifice a little bit of DPS and accuracy to have the comfort of not needing potions or cure me. In terms of how that changes the calculations, it only drops the DPS by a couple percent. On red phase, the T-Bow does end up becoming stronger since it was so close to begin with, but once again, that's only by a couple percent. A big note here on the blue phase, despite wearing a Serp Helm in the slot as opposed to Crystal Helm, the Bow of Faerdhinen still out DPSs the Blowpipe with Amethyst Darts. Next up, we have Vorkath. Vorkath is somewhere you're probably using, you know, the Dragon Hunter Lance or maybe the Dragon Hunter Crossbow, but let's take a look at these calculations here. The Bow of Faerdhinen is better than both the T-Bow and the Blowpipe here. The difference for both, roughly 12% better than the T-Bow and 2% better than the Blowpipe. If for whatever reason you're still using Blowpipe against Vorkath, if you bring something like a BGS spec or Dragon Warhammer spec, the Blowpipe will overtake the F-Bow. Plus, since the Bow of Faerdhinen has huge range, you will be unable to Wookswalk. Even though the bow is better than both options here, it's probably not going to be what's taken here since there's so many other options. And if you do go with one of these, you probably want to be able to Wookswalk, so you'd probably take the Blowpipe. Next up, we're going to be taking a look at Jad and Zuck. For Jad, the best in slot is the T-Bow. No surprises there. It's roughly 20% better than the F-Bow. However, when we're comparing the F-Bow to the Blowpipe, it completely blows the Blowpipe out of the water. It's 30% stronger to use the F-Bow with the set over the Blowpipe. So the gap between the Blowpipe and the T-Bow has definitely been filled there. As for Zuck, obviously you can't use the Blowpipe there, but if we're comparing the T-Bow and the F-Bow, the T-Bow is better by roughly 15%. Not too bad overall. If you're going for your first Infernal Cape and you can't afford a T-Bow, that's probably a good option. I believe if you got really lucky with specs on Zuck, the Armadale crossbow might be better, but otherwise I think the Bow of Faerdhinen is going to have more DPS overall. If anybody actually knows the calculations between the Bow of Faerdhinen and the ACB, I'd be very interested to know how it would do. Now, if you're on a Slayer task for either of these monsters, everything remains the same. However, the gap between the T-bow and the F-bow gets larger, the T-bow gets a little bit stronger, and the gap between the Bow of Faerdhinen and the Blowpipe gets smaller, only marginally. The F-bow is still going to be way better than the Blowpipe at Jad. The Calphite Queen during the second phase. This is assuming a Slayer Helm since most people do it on task. However, I don't really think it changes the calculations. The best in slot weapon here is the Bow of Faerdhinen. When comparing the Blowpipe to the Bow of Faerdhinen, the Bow of Faerdhinen is 10% stronger than the Blowpipe. I think here, if you were to bring Dragon Darts with the Blowpipe, the bow would still be roughly around 5% stronger. Really cool here, definitely a certified best in slot. At Cerberus, the T-bow is the best in slot. It is 20% stronger than the Bow of Faerdhinen and 15% stronger than the Blowpipe. Based on those numbers, you can tell that the Blowpipe is a little bit stronger than the Bow of Faerdhinen, roughly 3%. You'll probably want to bring the Blowpipe here over the bow, especially since you have the spec. That being said, obviously Cerb is a place where people bring the Arc Light. Hydra, another case where maybe you'll bring the Dragon Hunter Lance instead, but if you are going range, the T-bow is amazing here. It is the best in slot here. Up next, we have the Blowpipe, followed by the Bow of Faerdhinen. The gap between the Bow of Faerdhinen and the T-bow is 29% roughly. And the gap between the Bow of Faerdhinen and the Blowpipe is about 10% here. So if you are going ranged, obviously you have the T-bow. But if you don't own the T-bow and you're choosing between the Bow of Faerdhinen and the Blowpipe, you'll definitely want to bring the Blowpipe. At Hydra, people tend to wear the crystal top and bottom for the prayer bonus since you're not taking damage there. And since you're not taking damage there, you're actually not using a lot of shards in the actual crystal armor. So with that, you might think that the Bow of Faerdhinen is a natural choice here, since you already have those two pieces. However, the Blowpipe is better, so we're going to be bringing the Blowpipe here. That being said, there are some strategies during certain phases, like the lightning and whatnot, where maybe bringing the Bow of Faerdhinen, if you have it as a quick switch to get a couple hits in, might be worth it. Last up, we have Dawn. Dawn is one of the Grotesque Guardians. The T-bow is atrocious here, we won't be using that, but when we compare the Bow of Faerdhinen to the Blowpipe reigns supreme. It is roughly 15% stronger than the Bow of Faerdhinen, so you'll definitely be taking the Blowpipe over the bow. So overall, where is the new bow the best in slot? It is the best in slot at Skeletal Mystic, the Magic Vanguard, the Abyssal Portal for the Vespula Room. Bandos, it is the best in slot. Arma, it's sort of the best in slot, but you're definitely going to be bringing chins there most of the time. And the last certified best in slot is the Calphite Queen during the second phase. Another question people will have is the upkeep cost between the three weapons. In terms of the Blowpipe, I don't want to give any specific numbers here. I recommend just going to the Blowpipe wiki page. It always has a total cost there. But right now, with Amethyst Darts, it's going to cost roughly, you know, 400 to 500k an hour of constant shooting, which is definitely not always the case. A lot of people have been discussing if they should sell the Twisted Bow and whatnot. As you can see from these calculations, the Twisted Bow is still very much a best in slot in a lot of areas. But the other thing to consider here is the Twisted Bow is also the cheapest one to use. Some people have mentioned that the bow is cheaper to use because you can charge it and make it corrupted. But given the fact that in most of these places you're going to be taking damage, you're going to need the shard upkeeps. So when we're comparing the T-bow's Dragon Arrow cost, the Dragon Arrow cost is going to be the lowest between all three options. Now taking a detailed look into the Bow of Faerdhinen, what is the upkeep cost like? Well, if you're at places where you're taking no damage, like the Giant Mold, the upkeep cost is obviously going to be nothing, assuming you have corrupted your bow. In terms of other spots where you take no damage, there really isn't much. You could argue Hydra, but why would you bring it to Hydra over the other options? So looking at some of the more realistic areas like Raids, Bandos, Zalra, and Ceridomen, what is the cost like? Well, based on my tests here, I did roughly, you know, 50 or so KC, and I found that every KC was costing roughly a third of a shard. So over the span of, let's say, around 30 Bandos kills, I was using about 10 crystal shards. If you're an Iron Man or a main, the gauntlet provides you with roughly 12 crystal shards per kill. Now, you might be thinking it's lower than that since you can't even get over 9, but you need to factor in getting the armor seeds and the weapon seed. When you factor that in, 12 is in fact the average. So if it takes me roughly 35 Bandos kills to use about 12 shards, I'll need about one gauntlet to cover that on average. Zalra is actually very similar to that as well. The cost will vary. At Sarah Doman, I tend to take a little bit less damage since I have better range defense. So I might be able to do something like 40 Sarah kills for every gauntlet I need to do. If you're not going to do the gauntlet, but maybe you're going to do Zolcano or Agility, you can factor exactly how much it's going to cost. Just plug in the average shards that you get. Now, if you're a main, you might never want to do any of this content. So what is it going to cost you to upkeep? Well, you'll need to buy one of the three seeds, the Armor Seed, Weapon Seed, and Teleport Seed. The Armor Seed provides you with 250 shards, the Weapon Seed provides you with 10, and the Teleport provides you with 150 shards. You'll need to buy one of those three seeds. You'll probably want to buy the one that's most efficient, so what you'll do is you'll divide the GE cost by the number of shards it gets you to get the lowest possible price per shard. So overall for mains, there's definitely going to be variability depending on how much you get hit, but in content where you are getting hit, it looks like this is going to cost you probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 200k per hour. So comparing that to the blowpipe, it looks like it might still be generally cheaper, assuming the bow is corrupted. Something else to keep in mind here, if we look at examples like Slayer or Zalra where you're using the Serp Helm, in those cases you can reduce these costs by 33% since you won't have the helmet, so you'll be losing less shards. This is one of the reasons why I decided to take Serpentine Helm at Zalra, since it was such a nice quality of life and it cost me less. Speaking of quality of life, I want to make some points about the bow that aren't demonstrated in the DPS calculation. I've spent a good amount of time trying this bow with different content, and I was able to determine little fun things about it that I thought made the bow really, really awesome. The biggest thing is the range. The range is absolutely massive. It is a range of 10 on rapid. That is equal to an Armadale crossbow on long range. The range of the bow makes stuff like Vasa, Ohm, Ice Demon, and Shamans a lot easier to move around. Another example of this is at Zalra. We've already said based on DPS calculations that this looks like it's going to be better than the blowpipe there. However, there are some phases at Zalra where with the blowpipe, you wouldn't be able to DPS Zalra because the poisonous clouds are in the way. With the crystal bow, you can actually shoot beyond the poisonous clouds. Another area where this range was a huge quality of life was getting God Wars kill counts. It was very easy to tag monsters from pretty much across the map. It also costs nothing to use because we don't really take damage during KC, and obviously the corrupted bow costs no ammo. So not only did this seem to speed up kill count, it also meant that I was using a lot less energy running around tagging monsters. Speaking of saving energy, same thing applies at the Giant Mole. Giant Mole does require you to run around, but with this bow, you're going to be tagging him from a lot farther away. I noticed myself using a lot less stamina pots as a result. Some people might plug into the calculation and maybe Darox might be more DPS, but honestly, the fact that I can safe spot the mole and I also use a lot less energy, plus I'm tagging him quicker, I honestly think the bow is just better there. If you want to view any of these calculations or images, there's a link in the description to the Twitter account. I have it posted there. You can also follow that account if you want more data and more memes. Some people might be talking a little bit about the Theater of Blood. I'm not sure what the meta is going to be there. I know people were full void, so I just assumed that it wouldn't be used there, but we'll see how that develops. If you found this video helpful, I'd appreciate a like. I saw a lot of people on YouTube looking at the bow, but I got a ton of questions while live streaming talking about how this bow compares to T-Bow and Blowpipe, as well as the cost of the bow, which hasn't really been looked into. Subscribe to my channel for more content, including this roguelike series that I developed. We randomly generate monsters, bosses, encounters. It's a lot of fun. We got classes and relics. Here's a link. Thanks for watching. Bye.